goal for, you know, all of these gatherings we're having. I don't think I've talked about this at all. As a parent organizer, and talking about digital presence for being online, and especially from the position of digital citizenship, my goal is that the information I share with you, that you will take it and share it with someone else. Everything and way, way more. I don't know if any of you have gotten the chance to go into the website and find, you know, the wealth of information that has been designed so that if you want to do an event at your church, synagogue, temple, Girl Scout group, gathering of friends, family, it includes a flyer that you can just put your date and time in. It includes a guide for hosting the event and to talk through the event. It includes materials that, and like I've shared with you, and much more that you can share with whoever attends your event. It gives you, it will give you a timeline to work from. But most of all, that's what, as a parent organizer, where our work was designed by Howard Gardner at Harvard on as far as how to organize in a community. And we use a snowflake design so that as I reach out to you, each one of you will create a snowflake around you that will extend out even further. And you were asking earlier, you know, is this being shared with students anywhere? Well, we do have a component that is for students and for schools. And if you, we can make that available to you, and you'll see that online as well. And I guess it will be more a matter of just extending. You all already, I'm sure, have a deep reach into this school, into South Pasadena schools, and helping to share the information with them so that the students can be, because the best, the number one protection for a child is their parents' awareness. But I would also say there's two number ones. The other one is that they're informed. And as in all things, if they're informed, that's why we have them in school. That's why we, you know, teach them is media literacy and media and digital citizenship are really, it's like not quite, it's not, no, actually, it's not in our schools. Now in England, in the UK, in Australia, in Canada, it is a part of, it's mandatory. But it's something that we can move to.
So I just, and my babysitter showed up in the, and she is like just 1 year out of high school.
Uh-huh.
And we talked briefly about what I'm attending. You know, she said, so she is 20, right? She's
uh-huh.
20 or 19, 20. She said, I'm the first generation where this was introduced. And anybody after is just growing up with it. And how new it is. So she says, I know a bunch of kids that don't want to use all the time their phones. But I see all the others I interact with that that's the last generation, the 20-year-olds now.
Right.
Because
yes.
That's exactly, she says, it was, I, you know,
right.
Remember still a time where it wasn't an iPhone.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's interesting.
Yeah.
So we don't, we are so young with this that,
oh.
Even, I mean, I'm glad you're talking about it, but in
well,
20 years, it backfires.
And
or 15.
And so the young people who come after her are considered digital natives.
But it would be great if the 20-year-olds could teach this class to us.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Because they're so, they're
but
just.
They're living it.
Yeah.
And
but
they're right there.
Olds, I think,
huh?
But even the 20-year-olds kind of came into it later, I think.
Right.
I think even some of them weren't using it as much as these guys are, right? So.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's why it would
even
be good for,
teacher.
Because the teenagers are looking up to those more than. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
To us,
yeah.
But they look much up to their guidance.
Uh-huh.
I don't know how to make that happen. That would be really cool, you know, to get her or somebody like her to
uh-huh. And I think
do it for middle school or even high schoolers, because they're only 3 years older, to
yes.
just share and say, hey, we don't have it. You know what I mean? And give it on.
Absolutely.
That's
right.
I know some.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's definitely one of the strategies.
But I don't know
good
how.
Strategy. Yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, one way might be to, so are there like video classes?
Was it broadcast journalism class?
Those are students that definitely, because they're taught, you know, especially from a journalistic approach, they're taught to be vigorous in investigating and looking at all sides. It could even be someone from an art class who's really studied art to a point that you don't look at the surface, you're looking at what's behind. What don't I see? You know, there's a lot of different approaches to investigation. And especially with the digital, you want to include the art as well as the journalism, because when you get into what is color, what colors affect you, and how, and when you get into the video, it's angles that affect you.
No, is I it, understand all that, but it's so hard to bring to translate it, because she says, you know, she babysits and she works with youth, and but the parents, you know, they just allow it. So she goes in and everybody's on the iPhone,
right.
So that's what they
right.
do, and then they go to bed.
Right.
Because we don't allow that in our family. She's like, so, well, what do you do with your kids? She says, well, usually we're just on iPhones, if you want to be honest, you know? And it's like, okay, that's, you know?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
So it's pretty much they've ran out of alternatives of fighting it or something.
And there's a lot of reasons why, that's for sure.
Well, it's, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I understand the reasons.
Yeah. But it is a really good. It's a really good idea to do, and if there's anything I can do to help you organize that, please let me know, and
mm-hmm.
I will do my best to, you know, facilitate that.
I think about it more.
Yeah.
Because it just came up with birds tonight.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it might even be something that you might even do through, for example, PCC, an extended program,
mm-hmm.
you know, as far as, you know, bringing other young, older young people in to help you do it. Just to ground it, you know, with information. It doesn't even have to be that formal. It could be a very informal. You know, when my kids, what got me started studying communications was, so I had kids young, and so then I went back to school. I went back to school because I started showing movies in the neighborhood. My kids are in their 40s at this point. And I started showing movies in the neighborhood, and I didn't like, when I was a kid, 10-cent movies. And if you came to the movies, if you didn't have 10 cents, if you helped sell popcorn or, you know, sell movie tickets, then you got in for free. And so I specifically chose to show movies that I thought were about different cultures and, you know, different ideas that were engaging. It's like the first one I showed was about a little Navajo girl whose grandmother was dying, and her grandmother wanted to share, when I finish weaving this rug, I'll be gone. But I want you to get used to that, you know. And so we did Five Chinese Brothers in Spanish, you know. So just like those kind of things. Back at that time, when it was on TV, you know, there wasn't a lot of choice. And that's when I decided, I'm going back to school and get my degree in, you know, communicating in film. And, you know, especially children's film and television. So, but I did it in the neighborhood, you know, and at a community house, and there's so many ways, and I know that you ladies all have some deep roots in getting things started in your community, so I know you come up with some ideas, and I'd love to hear what they are.
Us, the seven of us.
Thousands of kids.
So, and I appreciate you. Thank you for sharing, you know, your interaction with your babysitter and sharing that with us. Is there any, did anybody else have any kind of, you know, reactions from last week?
I think it would be interesting at the high school level to see it be a student-led group, because there are so many different clubs and organizations at the high school that the students are passionate about that they start on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like this is sort of ripe for that kind of discussion or development.
Uh-huh.
But you'd have to find, again, the right students. Like the students who were here last week, I'm not saying it has to to be them or anything, but it seems like they, you know, follow, they're following what their parents are saying to them, they're studious, and they're interested in learning seemingly more about how it's all working.
Right.
So you would need those types of students to get involved. It might be a way to reach more kids, because there isn't a class at the high school that is, you know, we don't have broadcast journalism at the high school, so.
Just like a panel of kids, because I know, like, I have a son, a sophomore. So, well, she's a sophomore, I love them digital, but there's one friend that removed herself from Instagram, from, you know, all this Twitter, and I asked her why, and she just said she realized the effect it's having on her. And she wanted to focus more time on schoolwork, sports, etc. And then she realized, you know, she was a little more depressed because she's watching other people's lives. But then she also realized she disconnected herself with all that. It was such a social thing that she didn't have much commonality with other friends now. Right? So
yeah, so that would be the theme. You know, it's like, you know, that's exactly what it is. You're not connected. You need it. You need it, actually.
You need it for that generation. It's their life.
But it's
their social network.
It is.
Right?
You have to have a little bit of it,
but not too much.
So if that's
how do you use it to get productive, to get together with same interest groups, and not use it when you're getting together?
We're going to look at that a little bit today.
Okay.
Within the cyberbullying arena. Yeah. Anyone else have something? That was really good. Yeah. For example, that's a really good one.
If you have like a panel you're looking for, maybe, or just to come visit here, or
at the high school.
It would have to at the high school. I was just thinking it would be a club that a student or a group of students would start, where they're just getting together to either research effects or come together and turn off for an hour, you know, I don't know, you know, what it is, but there are students who have those desires, so, or just, you know, picking a topic each time, I don't know, to discuss, but they're really the thought leaders, like, none of us are the thought leaders, we didn't, you know, we're just trying to catch up,
yeah,
you know,
like, connect or
really,
something, you know,
that's cute, man.
Yeah.
I wonder if like a club venue I think is good, and if they did something like a Socratic seminar where they pose questions, right, to kind of pursue and think about in the midst of their peer group, because that your son's friend is probably not the only one who's feeling like, you know, a little down, a little depressed, and, you know, noticing it, but then how do you find a balance, right? Proactive, intentional, good choices about how you use the device. That's really the tough question.
It is, and it's probably within the conversation that they will raise some of those answers up themselves.
Right.
But then they do need someone maybe to facilitate,
right,
to kind of like help to bring in some other things that are known. So for this past week, we had Tristan Harris. He's now part of Common Sense, and he is he was a former Google design ethicist, and he was the founder of the Center for Humane Technology, and he has a TED Talk that you might want to check out. And it's
Tristan Harris.
And he's talking about, and it's the manipulative tech companies use to capture our attention, and especially the attention of kids. It's 17 minutes, and I'm not going to show it, but please check it out.
Do you know what the name of the talk
is? It's the manipulative tricks tech companies use to capture your attention. And one of the things he talked about was not Instagram, but
Snapchat.
So that when you fill in the minute someone who's your friend starts typing, it will send you a notification. And whether they're typing to you or not, you're getting a notification. And so
depressing if it's not to you.
And it's
a distraction.
So that helps to create the addiction. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with YouTube, the addiction is created because as soon as you, it's that thing, as soon as you get finished with one, here's another one coming at you that's almost, it's somewhere in the, you know, area of what you're interested in. And there's no stopping.
Yeah.
So you have to, it's pushing at you.
Right.
You have to stop
that
yourself.
That happened when I watched this first session today. So it was almost over, and then it went over, and the next time I'm alone, I'm like, what? Yeah.
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 Yeah, exactly, exactly. And that's how...
Autoplay feature.
Right.
Sorry?
The autoplay feature.
Yeah,
autoplay. Cues up that next
right, video. Exactly. So he's working with Common Sense right now. And we're working on, you know, especially Snapchat, Facebook, same companies, and I'm trying to break down that some of that auto cue future to transform that future to something instead of making it about. So we become the product, right? And instead of making us the product, doing something for good. How can it be used for good? Which is something else we're going to take a look at today with a couple of the videos that I have. Another person that is on our website is Emily B-A-Z-E-L-O-N.
B-A-Z-E-L-O-N. But she's on your website.
Yes.
Okay.
And a video with her talking, interview with her. And she's... she has a book and on Sticks and Stones, Defeating the Culture of Bullying and Rediscovering the Power of Character and Empathy. So those are two pieces that, you know, that we, you know, to look a little deeper into what's going on with all this, but especially Tristan's work, because I have to say that it really, I went to hear him speak and I kept thinking, yeah, but I know that I can, I'm not going to just like, you know, roll over just because it pops up on my feed that, you know, the story is, but then when I had to stop and think about it, because I've been doing a lot of work with rent and homes, housing, affordable housing, and a story popped up. I had to wonder about that story, because it talked about the costs, what you needed in every state across the country, how much money you needed to make to get a rent a two-bedroom apartment. And so like California was like $33 an hour, and Hawaii was $35, so those were the two top, and New York was like $35. And then I thought, is this popping up just because I do so much reading about affordable housing, or is this a real story? And it was from Yahoo, so I didn't know if I should trust it. You know, so yeah, there's a lot to be said for it's the business model, and that's what he was. That's what his work is in, the changing that business model and making it make more of a philosophical model or a philanthropic model instead of, you know, an avarice model.
There's also some article I'm trying to find it.
Yeah.
It's a Common Time magazine or something, but there was a group of guys that are neuroscientists who are like studying neuroscience and don't like the way that everything's headed with all the awards and everything and how it's making, it's like a negative thing to get these rewards. It's really making you be on the machines more. They're trying to code some things that are going to like help you learn something, like make, I don't know if they're going to give you rewards, but they're using the neuroscience that they have learned in order to actually take technology. And they know they're not going to turn around, but they're going to take technology and make it for good as opposed to make it kind of for bad and make you kind of go over here where you're never doing anything.
Right.
They wanted to help you learn things and do and be productive in your life. I'll try and find an article and bring it next week because it was,
yes.
It was, clearly I didn't read the whole thing, but the beginning part of it was really interesting. Yeah, you do that, you're like,
right.
Yeah, you read
one page out of six.
And then also, I mean, when you learn, you kind of learn in waves, so that, you know, the first time you don't get, you gotta go back a couple of times to really, you know. Okay, so, was there anything else that anyone got from the young people, or questions that, you know, that need to continue to be answered?
Well, the only thing I'd say is, I think the idea of the high school sounds really great. I think the thing, and I don't know how to do it, and I don't know if I have the time or energy yet, but I think the thing that we need to do as parents in South Pasadena is go to the school board and say, this is ridiculous, we need to be teaching a digital media curriculum in elementary school, in middle school, and at least, you know, because if you start it young, they all have Chromebooks in third grade, so they're all on these things already. They can't look up a ton of stuff at school, but it's starting already.
And they're allowed to use it for personal use once they're finished with
and
the project.
And they're supposed to go home and use their computers and all the stuff, but yet we're not really giving them a good curriculum and a good start.
And understanding
and
what it, the power of the tool and how to not only manipulate it, but be manipulated by it. Yeah,
and the fact that, you know, like you said, the UK, Australia, and Canada have done this. Really?
We can do it
too. No wonder we're getting far behind. Mm-hmm. Like, if we can't implement something so basic, that just seems silly.
And if you are ready to do that, I will, I'm inviting her to come anyway. Sue Thoris, who's our education person here in the greater Los Angeles area, that's her specialty. Her background is in community health, but she considers this community health.
Yes.
Yeah. She'll be willing to come and we can give you ideas. I'm, you know, as far as, you know, approaching that. Because, yes. So I think we all have a pretty good idea of what cyberbullying is, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
How would you define it?
It's unwanted, it's information that you do not like or want, for sure, right?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
That you're exposed to.
Uh-huh, yeah. Is there anything you want to add to? Anyone wants to add to that?
Well, the bullying goes further, but that starts with that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
where you
and
have to
words,
detect it and cut it off.
Attitudes, ideas. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it might be someone saying, so and so, just because they got finished reading the book, just because they were finished reading, they had to raise their hand in class today. And so, if you're in that classroom, you know who that person is. And it's almost passive on one hand, but it's not on the other. You know, it starts off mild, but it can go much deeper. So first I'm going to show you a YouTube video. Stop right there. And I want to ask you, is there anything that particularly stands out in this second video where the teens are reacting? Is there anything particularly stands out to you about that?
Well, my daughter just taught me that it's absolutely okay to say you're gay. As you know, you're a little off, you're a little weird, you're a little funny, you're a little whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we have talked much about it, we are in gay communities, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, why would you even say that? Oh, don't take it so serious.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So some of them I thought were taking it very serious, and the other ones.
Some of the, on this last video?
Yeah, maybe not so, you know?
Any comments about the first video?
It reminded me a lot of 13 Reasons Why.
Yes, yes.
Where the girl just kept making bad decisions also.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, watching 13 Reasons Why was very frustrating for me. Mm-hmm. It's like, that was in that, like, what are you doing? Can you learn from your mistakes?
Right.
I kind of got annoyed at her because I was, you know, maybe I just watched it, but.
Yeah.
She just wanted to be like, stop.
And where was someone who could she be pulled in? Could she be reined in? And where was someone to do that?
Yeah, but you can see how it happened. I mean, you just kind of want to be loved so much that you make stupid decisions.
Yeah. Is there quiet because it's disturbing, or is it quiet because it's
well,
kind of
it's disturbing, and
if
we know that in South Pass High there were already this year 30 kids hospitalized for suicide, it's disturbing, you know, it's happening right here, right now, right? And we don't really know how to get them out of there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not out of the school, that's not the solution.
Right, but how to kind of
right.
Reach
so
out to them.
Schools is probably not the
solution
to this.
Yeah.
I just wish there was a way. If there's that many kids that are that sad, why aren't we talking about it more?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we need, it feels like, I don't want to normalize, you know, it's normalize isn't the right word, but you want to make it a discussion that can happen where people feel comfortable talking about it and being able to come forward. But like the kids are saying, you know, you don't always have someone you can go to. You know, you don't want to talk to your parents, you don't want to talk to your kids. They're adults. It's like you were saying, like if you can find a 20-year-old,
right?
You know, they might be more likely to talk to somebody like that.
Right. And in this age of communications, all this communication going on, communication is not really happening.
Yeah. I have a friend whose son seems like the happiest son of the person in the entire world, and I guess over Christmas break he was feeling down a little bit, and he called the suicide hotline.
Mm-hmm.
And ended up telling his mom about it, and she's like, well, what's wrong? Like, I had no idea. And he's like, I just felt sad that day. And like, even
that's
just him having that number was really helpful for him, because he was nowhere near committing suicide.
Right.
But he kind of got, she's like, well, what was it like? And he's like, it was really nice. Somebody was there and was listening to me and could talk to me about what was going on. And I felt a lot better afterwards.
Well, that's.
So maybe that's one thing. Is the suicide hotline posted largely in the bathrooms of the high school?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's at the train track, but is it largely
right.
posted in the bathrooms of the high school to make an awareness that
mm-hmm.
this is actually needed in the bathrooms of
right.
the high school? You know what I mean?
And, you know, one of the things that we do, we really
we do
been working on in common sense is, and this is a hard area to talk about and walk in, but mental health. And it's not necessarily like your lack of mental health, but sometimes you just need a little, like you say, a little boost, a little pinch, and you really can't turn to. And so maybe that's another issue that, you know, he figured out for himself how to find what he needed.
Yeah.
And then to share it afterwards.
Yeah.
That he needed it.
And he and his mom, like, my son doesn't. Who's the same age, doesn't talk to me that much, but he says everything to his mom. He's just a talker, and she's
uh-huh.
a talker. And
yeah.
She
yeah.
was like, I couldn't believe he hadn't said anything, you know? So even when he had a talker, he still didn't say
yeah.
he was sad one day.
Yeah. Wow.
It was just, it was sad. But I don't know how he got the number. I think it's somewhere in high school they told him about it or something, and so he just kept the card or kept whatever it
uh-huh.
is.
How old
is he? 9th grade. Not someone I ever would have expected,
mm-hmm.
you know, to have that. And I don't think he was that sad, but for him, he was sad.
And maybe because he normally was so buoyant
yeah.
to have these feelings, what does he do with them?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I'm glad he caught them, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably.
guys are all talking about high school. I don't.
No, but I feel like
middle school. Yeah. Because I think middle school is a hard adjustment for kids, and they're just trying to figure it out. And I think if they're getting that extra, you know, bullying or whatever, it just makes it that much harder. And I think if they just felt like, geez, I had somewhere to go, you know, as a sixth grader, you know, then once they get to high school, then I think, you know, not that they would at least have that experience and they know where they could turn to and they know that there's support out there.
It almost goes back to what you were asking about. If there are like assemblies or some kind of forums within a health ed class or something, then are they talking about this in health ed?
They don't
have
that.
They don't have that, I think.
I mean, you have like sex ed in seventh grade in your science class, and then you have a health class for a semester in high school when you take it. And you can take it anywhere between 9th and 12th grade.
But that's, what you said was making me think about the two kids. Yeah, I mean, last week the two kids obviously were pretty solid kids, you know. I wish that we would have heard from one that's a bit shaky.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they were very solid kids.
Yes.
And, but both of them said that they don't think you should have a cell phone in middle school because you're just way too shaky.
Right.
You know, so it validated my policy, but you know what I mean? It is really hard if you're even, this started in seventh grade. You're not ready for this in seventh grade.
Right. I think in our education system, it makes it hard because, you know, teachers are, you know,
right.
Go look on the web for this. They're utilizing all of that, you know, the internet access and stuff like that. It just puts it out there for kids. Like it's essential.
Yeah.
I mean, for them to have access to all of this stuff, which just opens up all of the problems.
I think so too.
That, you know.
At that age.
Yeah.
You know, there's a certain age where it's really beneficial to have all that access, but not in seventh grade.
Right.
And at that time in their lives, they are chemically going through more changes than almost any other time in their life they're going to. And so, I mean, there's things happening in their body that...
Right. Their hormones are going all over the place, and they can't even make rational decisions. And then
Doesn't even develop.
and then on top of that, you got other kids being mean to other kids, and then they're like, oh, wait, what's wrong with me, you know, in the whole midst of just trying to figure out middle school. I think it's really hard.
Well, let's take it in a different direction.
Sorry.
After we've been over there, let's take it in a different direction.
And I have Sophia, like my eighth grader is in a group where she's now, you know, it's through our UU church, where it's all about mental health and sex and healthy relationships and unhealthy relationships and dating and everything.
Yeah.
But that's at the end of eighth grade, that's too late. Like, it's just too late, you know?
You can't
enroll a seventh grader. I think we need something here for seventh grader. Maybe you know.
So we had the More Than Sex Ed program that some of us were in last year. We had our eighth graders in last year, which we thought was too late too.
Mm-hmm.
So we started putting our sixth graders in last year, and they talked about a lot of this stuff.
In school here?
No, it was a great program it's this company called More Than Sex Ed, and we had them doing it in Orange Grove Park.
Okay.
The problem is the way the company decided to move is they were doing it once a month, and they decided they were going to do it every week instead. was too much to ask of our kids, so we pulled
my daughter Sophia is doing it every week for
is
a
it
period
for kids
of 5 months.
Is it for parents?
It was for kids.
No, for kids. Okay.
It was for kids.
Parents are not even
there is
about.
A parent thing on Monday. Does everybody know about that? The sex thing at the high school?
Doesn't that go where they say, is that the thing that I saw? I feel like I
probably.
Saw
it.
Probably.
It's really dumb.
Yeah.
It's a PTSA thing.
Isn't that already the bunch the sex?
No, there's a thing this coming Monday at the high school.
But I'm just saying, you're right, the middle schoolers need it. You're talking about high schoolers.
Right, I mean,
but
just because so everybody's exposed to it such as
yeah,
right,
right.
Right.
Grade one?
That, I mean, so, you know, us growing up as middle schoolers, we had our own issues, but it was never on top of like all the social media kind of stuff. And I just think it exaggerates, and it's just really hard for kids to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even the language used in video games
right.
they play together.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
you
it's
know,
just.
It's everywhere.
Right.
Yeah.
And I just think, yeah.
No,
kids are a lot smarter than I was. Yeah,
sure.
You know.
They are.
And so you might as well give them
some
knowledge,
some
support.
Yeah, some something to help them analyze and then synthesize that information that they're taking in. And so they aren't just being inundated with unfiltered information.
Right.
Okay, so let's
change them.
Would you tell us about that thing?
So, how do we look at this in relationship to the other video?
Yeah, it's the other end of the spectrum. It's technology for good and for building up and for community and so heartwarming, right?
My goodness.
Yeah.
I have to say, when I watched it, it was like after seeing the other ones too, that it was just like, okay, so there is that other edge of the sword.
But he could have gone down. It was just one decision somebody made.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, one kid probably who started it, he could have gone down the opposite way.
Right?
So
like the
randomly
girl,
picked.
Like Amanda Todd.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Right.
So I think that some of the suggestions that you were talking about as far as, you know, organizing to deal with issues that aren't necessarily embedded in social media will begin to kind of like open up the possibility of young people who stand up. What do you think? I think it would help. Yes.
So both like the contrasting, but there nothing we talk about parents, obviously. Like with children and parents, how we can be on the same page, sometimes be a speaker, advocate at the same time. I feel like maybe, you know, we can just part of us, like a kids feel, oh, my parents, no knowledge, don't want to talk about. Then if we know, we learn, but we don't know sometimes how to really, you know, to come to like a kid, like their world to communicate.
Well, I think we did touch on it. We did touch on, you know, this event at the high school. We did touch that we want the kids earlier in kid groups where this is educated, not, you know, I think because they're not looking at you for answer. So we kind of touched on that, I think, you know, if you can find a group for your kid to attend, that's a great thing, right?
Creating
an environment that they, you know, and this education, if you can, I think to get your kid into this environment, that, I mean, at the end, they have to be the one that sends the positive message, because you're not there, you don't know it. You know, so I think it's helping them, maybe showing them these videos would be good.
Yes.
I think we should show screenagers again all over the school district. You know what I mean? For it's like getting them exposed and informed and giving them the suicide hotlines and you know what I mean? And education, right, to the kids.
I almost wonder if it could be something that's handled through like the counselors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the counseling offices. It, I know they have a lot of kids that they're responsible for and stuff like that, but somehow create that form through the counseling services or something, like, I don't know, as a way to start
a dialogue.
Yeah.
An action.
Mm-hmm. Or just putting it out there for, you know, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if, you know, the classes in homeroom can take like 5 minutes every day.
Mm-hmm.
And
no, by contract.
Really?
We've been talking about this.
They have to, but they're not doing it.
By contract,
yeah.
They are not allowed to teach during homeroom.
Oh.
They're not allowed to do a thing.
Except take roll.
Yep. And watch over the kids. Now,
so
there might be like,
I wonder if like a student leader says, I will like click the buttons or I will lead a discussion.
Right. That could probably happen, but you just have to find.
Yeah.
Right now it's us. We
yeah.
really want this, but
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Unless we can find the students that are truly asking for it. I mean,
yeah.
That's the problem. I really wanted like a whole social, emotional, digital curriculum in the homeroom.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. Goodwill was like, ain't gonna happen.
Mm-hmm.
The teacher negotiations are too,
oh, wow.
They're just very strict on that and it drives me crazy.
Wow. It does. It has to be
really
student initiated,
yeah.
And yet our middle school students are brain damaged, right?
Yeah.
And
okay.
Not regulating
right.
And not thinking about all of those things. So when my oldest was in sixth grade, I remember meeting with his counselor and you know, I mentioned to her, he did not have a phone then, and we had a no phone policy for sixth grade, and, you know, he hounded, like every other kid has a phone, and, you know, the whole bit, and I said, we've really held off because we feel very strongly, and she said, you know, I deal with the worst case scenarios every day.
Mm.
She deals with the fallout that happens, like this kind of
mm-hmm.
cyberbullying, or you know,
well,
somebody sent a text.
Mm-hmm.
It was the one who just went on. She's on maternity leave.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna forget
her twin.
Yes.
Okay.
And so she was kind of applauding our decision to delay the smartphone. And I asked her if she had any resources,
mm-hmm.
and because I was interested in wanting to just, you know, educate myself, and it there wasn't really strong push, or I mean, she sent me a few websites, and you know, which I kind of looked into. But I feel like the conversation that begins here for us, it continues in, you know, in our home. And I go home and I download everything, you know, to my husband and to my son, and even the little ones, they're always listening.
Mm-hmm.
The phone is not an issue for them, but they know the rules that are kind of set and the expectations. So, like all of these videos, even the cautionary tale ones are so valuable.
Mm-hmm.
Like you want to, I mean, you don't really want to scare them. I mean, you kind of do want to scare them. You want to scare them. You don't want to traumatize them, but you want to scare them
mm-hmm.
enough to know this is the very real and present danger that's out there,
mm-hmm.
right?
I think not only that, but knowing how to recognize when you're the victim of cyberbullying, and then knowing right away what action you should take.
Mm-hmm.
That's
a hard judgment to make for a seventh grader,
mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And not getting
or
caught
sick,
up
I mean,
in it
saying,
yourself,
yeah.
and then knowing when is the time to say something to a trusted
mm-hmm.
adult.
Mm-hmm.
Because you want to be liked by those people. So
right.
you'll do anything to make them like you. Put
mm-hmm.
up with so much.
So, but I agree
that
so yeah, we want our kids to get this, I mean,
yeah.
Knowledge. And the thing is, you can, as a parent, can't really give it to them.
I mean, you can, but some kids don't want it from you.
My little one will be like, the older one, yes, I can talk to it. I'm literally
right.
Like,
da,
da, da, da, da, da, da, da. Not
yes,
listening.
I show video,
not, okay.
You could probably watch it, though. Like, any extra screen time.
Yeah.
You know, like, hey, kids, watch this video. Oh, is it a mom video? It is,
don't
but they'll still watch it.
In high school.
That's great.
A smartphone.
That's
in
great.
My family.
I'm really reconsidering.
And I'm very glad now that I did that.
Because my next one is a girl. And I'm just
high school, ninth grade. There are great phones that look just like an iPhone.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's scary.
Yeah.
They just have no data plan. And
yeah.
You can't do anything with them.
No social
but
media.
Text and call.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, there's a parental control. That's what I
yeah.
have for my seventh grade.
Yeah.
She is in the ASB, and there was time that the teacher sent out a group message saying that the place that they're going to meet change.
Yeah.
So she was the only one who
didn't
stood
get
there.
Oh.
Yeah.
No, I think you have to have a phone with text and voice.
Yeah. So
but you don't need a smartphone.
I ended up, like after that incident, I ended up giving her a old smartphone but with no data. Just,
exactly.
Just the phone and the text.
That's what I give.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
what I give in sixth grade too.
Right.
Because they need
well my
yeah.
fifth grader already asked me if he's going to get a phone when he goes to sixth
mm-hmm.
grade, and I told him probably.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And speaking of like when is a good time to like, I know you talk about the homeroom time that Mr. Kibler was saying no. What about at the beginning of the day, like someone would talk about the weather or something at that time, maybe to include a couple minutes of this information.
My son never listens to the AM class.
Yeah,
the people have that problem, they're usually chatting too much in the announcements, so he says he never hears anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's really true, but I think when it's that kind of stuff, because doesn't Mr. Kubla do the. There's the. Oh, he
the
writes it.
Yeah,
there's like
he
a
writes
bit.
It.
It's not that he writes it, but there's like a special like tagline that he. Has on like the emails he sends out and like talking about today we're going to talk about you know kindness or
yes,
I forget
yes.
who
like
what he calls this
wisdom. Uh-huh.
Yeah
wisdom.
Some wisdom thing and
is it to us or some of the kids
I think they say them in the morning and ask so too
maybe
there's like a theme every
yeah
day.
There's like
mm-hmm.
a theme every day or something
day. Mm-hmm.
But from what I get my kids aren't getting much out of that.
How do we get our kids educated? What sources do we have?
Like, where can we join? Where can they join?
Uh-huh.
That's more the question.
Well, you know, as I said, I mean, I'm not kind of like self-promoting, but it is there. We do have an educational component
mm-hmm.
that has a curriculum for digital in the schools. It will certify teacher, a school district as being ready to teach and teach the digital versus an analog, you know, approach to teaching. And you can see if, when you go online, you can take a look and see all of the different, you know, pieces of that curriculum that are right there. So, for example, within cyberbullying, there's and the woman I mentioned, Emily.
Yeah.
When that's presented as from the educator's perspective, it's like a 60-page PDF that is, you know, giving different, you know, points of view, giving different touch points to be worked with, different resources that teachers can use in talking to the students. And working through, not just talking to them, but like working through them, facilitating so that they work through
yeah.
this. So that's one thing I could offer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
As I said, I will try to get Sue to come here either next week or the week after. She's like our lead person on that in the Los Angeles area. She would have a lot more answers for you than I do. I will also look into it in case she can't make it here. But Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Because that should answer, I don't know what you mean, but that should answer you. You know, what? How can you parent your child? By educating or exposing them.
And I again also very much offer, go into the website, for parents, under for parents, look under the issues of just cyberbullying, but all of the things that we're talking about are in the website. And there are, you can get started with the fact sheets as I've handed out to you today. Then there's also, you know, there's more information, more resources, resources to books that continue the discussion, continue to inform, as well as more videos. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and one thing can lead to the other. Check out the TED Talk. I don't know if you were here when I mentioned the TED Talk. And it's by Tristan Harris. And it's it's called The Manipulative Tricks Tech Companies Use to Capture Your Attention. Mm-hmm. And then he's got a couple other, and once you go in there, that feed that we were just talking about, you will see other TED Talks that he's done specifically, as well as other people in the field, you know, looking at how this is affecting us. Especially how it's affecting young people. Now, as far as that answering your questions, probably the more informed you are, the more you can be a sounding board and a guidepost.
Yeah,
that's a lot.
Right, I think that's great to start with, to maybe watching together.
Mm-hmm.
She's sixth grade right now, so I think that would be appropriate for her to watch.
Absolutely.
The very
first. And there's, you know, you may not want her to watch that first video. Maybe you do, you know.
Okay.
It depends on her.
Yeah. Oh, I think I'm going to show that to my sixth grader.
Yeah.
I mean, she's at the end of sixth grade.
Uh-huh.
She's here right now. Right. So that's important.
Yeah,
because this started in seventh grade.
And then you're right there with her so that you can have that discussion.
Right.
Because it is disturbing.
It's heavy.
It is. You talked about 13 things.
13
reasons
why.
But many parents have the criticism of that show that it's glamorizing and it might the kids might want that glamour when they feel really good, so I don't.
But this isn't glamorous.
No, this isn't glamorous.
And it's
so that's why this is better.
And that's one of those things that that video is created at the lowest tech possible, still using a video camera, by using those sheets, those cards. And so that almost kind of, that's like almost like a documentary style, maybe even less than a documentary style. So that again becomes like some of those components like I was talking about earlier, that within the design of the message that you're receiving, you know, it puts you in a whole other state of seeing and receiving.
I'm waiting for somebody. There she is.
I have to go also.
Okay.
Thank you for coming. That second video, what was the name of it?
The second video was teenagers.
Yeah.
Teens React to Bullying.
No, sorry, the one where
they were hanging out. Oh, now that's a Facebook page. And it's called We Are All Daniel Q. C-U-I. We Are All Daniel.
Oh, We
Are All Daniel C-U-I.
Have you heard of We Are All Daniel Q, Sophia?
C-U-I.
Uh-huh.
We were watching that. That's a powerful thing.